వెల్కమ్ టు ఈ పీజీ పాఠశాల. ఐఎమ్ కే రాజన్, ప్రెసెంట్లీ వర్కింగ్ ఇన్ ద డిపార్ట్మెంట్ ఆఫ్ హిస్టరీ, పాండిచ్చేరి యూనివర్సిటీ. టుడే అవర్ సబ్జెక్ట్ ఆఫ్ టాక్ ఈజ్ ఇండియన్ కల్చర్. ద పేపర్ ఈజ్ ఆన్ ఇండియన్ ఆర్కిటెక్చర్. ద మాడ్యూల్ విచ్ వీఆర్ డీలింగ్ టుడే ఈజ్ రాక్ కట్ ఆర్కిటెక్చర్ ఆఫ్ పల్లవాస్. దీస్ రాక్ కట్ ఆర్కిటెక్చర్ ఆఫ్ పల్లవాస్ actually started with the period of Mahendra Varman first in 6th century AD. But in India, we are started that early rock cut architecture, particularly in and around the Barabar Hills and Nagarjuna Hills. And there, you are having a early rock cut architecture of Ajvigas first, then we are having Buddhist. Then this has been continued for a longer period of time, but we don't have any Brahmanical rock cut architecture till 2nd century AD. Then after that, in South India is concerned, we are having a Kadambas, Chalukyas and Pallavas and Pandyas. They also experimenting this rock cut architecture for Brahmanical deities. So that way this lecture is going to deal on the Indian rock cut architecture of particularly South India. So what are the objectives of this one is to know about the introduction of rock cut architecture in Tamil Nadu and to understand the techniques involved in the excavation of rock cut caves and to understand the evolutionary process involved in the rock cut caves, that particularly temples, rock cut temples, to estimate the impact of Pallava architecture in other parts of Tamil Nadu. So these Pallavas who ruled the northern part of Tamil Nadu, particularly up to Trichurappalli, the Kaveri deltaic region, and these kingdoms, the contemporary kingdoms are rulers like Pandyas of Madurai and Muthiyars of Kodumbalur also, simultaneously, they also experimented this rock cut caves. The whole of South India, the Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh and Tamil Nadu, experienced this rock cut caves, particularly in for Brahmanical deities. So there are three type of experimentation has taken place in the rock cut caves. So one is the rock cut cave temples, what we popularly call it as a cut-in temples. The natural rock or the boulder is cut or cave-in to create a rock cut caves. But these monolithic temples, what popularly called cut-out temples, that is that unnecessary rocks have been removed from top to bottom to create a monolithic rathas, what we popularly call pancharathas in Mahabalipuram. Then they have experimented the last phase of Pallava dynasty, the structural temples. That means brick by brick or stone by stone, they built the temples. So besides these temples, we are having some evolutionary process within this rock cut cave architecture. So what they popularly call Mahendra Varman style and Mamalla style. The Mahendra Varman first, who introduced these rock cut caves, has been continued by his son Narasimha Varman first, who has been called as Mamalla. So Mahendra Varman first ruled this country between 580 to 630 AD, and he excavated the rock cut caves for the Hindu deities. The excavation into hard rock and carving of the cave temple and sculpture would almost is considered as innovation in the case of Tamil Nadu, since there is has not now been any precedence before that. So it is considered this rock cut architecture during the time of Pallavas is considered the earliest one in Tamil Nadu. But before that, we are having, as I told you earlier, before that we are having Barabar, Nagarjuna Hills near Gaya. We are having Ajvigas and Buddhist, and also at Rajgriha, we are having a early rock cut temples. So it is not new, it is not new innovation, but it is only for the sake of Hindu gods, it is a new innovation. And the then after Mahendra Varman, the Mamalla continued the same rocket architecture, and in the southern part of Tamil Nadu, there's Pandyas continued these rocket caves. In fact, whether this is the first rocket cave, actually it has comes from his own inscription engraved on the walls of the Mandakapattu rocket cave. The Mandakapattu inscription of Mahendra Varman first is telling that a brickless, timberless, metalless and mortarless abode for Lakshita was caused to be made by the king Vichitra Chitta for the Brahma and Vishnu and Shiva. So that way the three Murti gods, first time he excavated in a hard rock. Unless otherwise in the northern India or in the part of Maharashtra and Karnataka, in Karnataka for instance, they have constructed or they excavated the rock of a sandstone. But whereas the Pallavas has excavated in the hard rock or gneiss or granite. So that way it is very difficult to make a cut-in temple in a hard rock. So that way there are a lot of difference between the Badami rock cut caves of Pallavas and also rock cut caves of Mahabalapuram. So for instance, if you see, this is the earliest rock cut Hindu temple of South India. It was excavated in Mahendra near Mamandur, and there is an inscription of Mahendra Varman first, which clearly says that this rock cut cave was first made. And accordingly, from starting from Mandakapattu, he excavated several places. This is the one, Lakshidayana Tirumurthy cave temple at Mandakapattu is the earliest one. And after that, we are having Panjapandava cave temple at Pallavaram, and Rudravalishwaram cave temple at Mamandur, Kal Mandapam cave temple at Kurangalil Muttam, and also Vishnu Graha at cave temple at Mahendravadi. So these are the rocket caves that he initial stage he has started. And again he has Vasandeshwara cave temple at Vallam, and Ralindangra Pallavaneshwara Graham. That is, there are two rocket caves in Trichurapalli. One is called upper rocket cave, the lower rocket cave. The upper rocket cave is belongs to the Pallavas and the lower rocket cave belongs to the Pandyas. So the Ralindangra Pallavaneshwara Graha, the upper rocket cave temple at Trichurapalli, is considered as the southernmost cave of Pallavas. Though we are getting certain rocket caves in Pudukottai, there are dispute regarding that caves, whether it is Pandyas or Pallavas. And there is a Satruva Malleswara Alaya cave temple at Dalavanur, and Avina Bhajana Pallaveshwara Graha cave temple at Shyamangalam excavated by Mahendra Varman first, the Pallava king. So what this rocket caves contains? Actually, the rocket is having a shrine cell at the rear wall, at this back wall, and in the front of this shrine cell we are having a rectangular mandapa. Then this rectangular mandapa consists of 4 or 6 or 8 equally spaced pillars in the saints. The pillars we are having two, between the two pillars, the distance between the two pillars are equal, so they call this intercolumnization. So the extreme pillars, that means that the end, that extreme end of the cave on the right end and left end of the cave temple, we are having off projected pillars. That off projected pillars are called, generally called as plasters. The front facet pillars are short and massive. If you see, the pillar is very short and massive. And that pillar, on the stem of the pillar, the topmost portion is in a cubicle, and the bottommost also cubicle, that is called sadram, and the in between we are octagonal. So this pillar also carry massive corbels with beveled or curved ends, sometimes with faces carved as a series of rolls, what we call taranga. Taranga means like a sea wave. So the taranga bodhika they call it. And the with median flange band will be there in between. So the band is called patta. So pillars are square in section at the base. So what they call it is sadram. And at the top with also again a sadram in shape. in the middle, it is octagonal in shape. This is the middle part is called kattu. The faces of the square sections of the pillar are adorned with lotus medallions. And the plain pillars also available. The massive beam over the brackets of the pillar also available. And there is no cornice or kabota above this beam. So without kabota, that means that a part which is available in the later temples, that is not available in Mahendravarman style. The rectangular mandava may be divided into front mukha mandava and the rear ardha mandava. If there are two, the mandava is so big or in larger in size, they have divided into two. So the front one is called mukha mandava and the rear one is called ardha mandava. The front mukha mandava and the rear is ardha mandava is shown with varying floor levels. There is no much difference in the height, just you are having a small variation in the floor level or in the ceiling levels also it has been represented. That way you can identify the mukha mandava or mukha mandava or ardha mandava. So this flight of rock steps from the floor of the mandava leads to the shrine. In the sense, if there are single mandava, then they will be having these steps goes directly from the mandava floor to the shrine cell. If there are two mandava, like a mukha mandava and ardha mandava, the flight of steps will shown in the ardha mandava leading to the shrine cell. The door frame is simple and without any decoration. A beam and a flux overhanging harness or kabota is cut on the top of this door. And the kapoda is adorned by semicircular kudu ornaments. What you can say, semicircular object will be there. So that is called kudu, with a flat shovel shaped finial above. So it's like a kalasa, what we are seeing in the temple, like that finial will be there above this kudu. The each shrine doors are generally guarded by two armed dwarapalas facing each other. The early cave temples had shrines for Trinity. What we have learned from Mandakapattu inscription, the Brahma, Shiva and Vishnu. See, Mandakapattu or Kunangalil Muttam and Mamandur, we are having a three shrines for the three gods. At Kunangalil Muttam had four additional shrines on the lateral walls. In the sense, it is not on the rear wall, what is the facing side, but it is on the side walls, the lateral walls, you are having the ardha mandava and mukha mandava, we are having a shrines, small cubical rooms are available, what we call shrine cells. The lateral cave temples are dedicated to either Shiva or Vishnu, so we don't have any shrine for Brahma. So Mahendravarman in Mamandur, we are having in a Vishnu temples, and the cave spaces are that cave temple, what Lord Cut cave temple faces east, that are west or south. For instance, the Mamandur Rock Cut cave temple faces east, the Mandakapattu cave temple faces west, and the Trichurapalli Rock Cut cave faces south. Probably depend upon the outcrop. The lotus medallion on the top of the or bottom of the cubical parts of the pillar, what we call chadrams, depicted in the late phase. So the medallion is very absent in the early phase, and later on they introduced this lotus medallion on the chadram of the pillar. In the medallions or in the place of medallions, and the medallions has been removed sometimes, the maharas and kinnaras or pushpalata or patralata are carved. So they have experimented by adding some more objects on the sadrams. The garbhagraha or what we call sanctum sanctorum or shrine cell are always empty and do not contain either rock cut linga or linga pita. Maybe it was believed that before Pallavas entering into Tamil Nadu, the megalithic monuments were very popular. Now, generally, the stone is considered inauspicious and is always used for graves. So, that may be probably restricted these Pallavas, keeping a linga or lingapita inside the shrine shell or any other icons. So there is a proper deity in the Garbhagraha. It is all known only through the inscription. But inscription says that there is a deity kept inside the Shantam Shantorum. Probably any objects of perishable material might have been used instead of putting in a stone or in a permanent material. The hind wall contains traces of lime plaster carrying a painting. So inside the shrine wall, inside the rear wall of the shrine, we are having a painting. So it seems that beyond these objects of perishable material, so there must be some painting behind that. This painting probably of depicting a Somaskanda. So Dwarabalas are found on either end of the mandavas or of the entrance when you go. The gatekeepers, the Dwarapalas, are found on either side of the mandapa. The Dwarapalas either face full front or in semi-profile or half turned towards the shrine door. So the difference between the Cholas and the Pallavas sculpture is that Cholas sculpture is completely projected, giving a three-dimensional view, whereas in Pallavas it is just emerging. So that way, these artisans also learning how to project these sculptures. See, Dwarabala stand resting on a massive club, and in this is we are having the serpent is shown within that club. So this is one of the Trichurapalli upper rocket cave. You could see that one. There are these pillars are very short, and the lower part of the pillar is in a square cubical in shape, that is sadram, and the middle part you see that it is faceted, so it become octagonal in shape, that is middle part, and the top part you are having a again square cubical shape, that is called sadram, and above the sadram, that is above this stem of this pillar, you could see that there is a cornice or carbel, or that is having a wavy pattern. You can see that that wavy pattern is called taranga. And you are having at the center of this wavy pattern, you could see there is a one band that is called patta. And the rear, this is the rear wall of this mandapa, will be having a shrine cell. But side walls, you have been depicted the sculptural representation. You could see here, this sculpture representation not completely three-dimensional. And you could see that sculpture, that Yajnopavida, is running over the right hand. This is the peculiar feature of the Pallava sculptures. So if you want to identify a Pallava sculpture, you could see the sculpture, the Yajnopavida, always running over the right hand. And if you see this one, lower rocket cave, but of course it has been excavated at Pandyas, but there is a little difference between the upper rocket cave and the lower rocket cave. The upper rocket cave of the Pallavas is earlier in date, and the lower rocket cave of Pandyas is little later in date, though we don't have inscription. But here you see the pillar. If the pillar you are having the sadram, and the top sadram is removed, and the lower part you are having the square in shape, the cubical part, the stem part is extended or lengthened, and it is having an octagonal in shape, and that middle part of the pillar you are having a malas. That after that, you are having a the usual pillars like a kalasa, thadi and kumbha, and over which you are having a ceiling. So, and the between the kapota and the pillar, you are having a cornice. You could see that above that kalasa, we are having a cornice, and it is in taranga pothika. Or taranga, there is no pothika. Pothika means it has to project a little outer from this cornice. And above that you are having a beam, or what we call that kapota. In the kapota you are having some kudu, that is semi-circular object is there. Over this kapota you are having a funnel, that means a small, on the right wall or the lateral walls of this cave, or in the on the hinder wall where you are having a shrine cell, is supported with the sculptural representation. On the shrine cell is on the first time they introduced in the later period, this adhisthana or what we can have like a pedestal like object at the base of this shantam shantorium, and this was the three or four steps will be leading to the Garbhagriha, and that's also rock cut cave. And after that, you can now Dwarapalakas are available not only in front of the mantapa, it is also available in front of the cave temples. So the shrine seal, and this is one, the Olaganeshwara temple and Mahishasura Mardini temple of later period. You here you see that that pillar has been changed from, it is unfinished one, and you can see that, but it is in circular in shape. So you can see that there are evolution within the pillar, and you can see the top of the cave. They try to make kapota like object, again cornice like thing they are started to making, and that is not in full now. And the steps they are attempted to make, and they are also leading to the mandapa, and the mandapa is little higher. So this unfinished cave, it clearly shows that still we don't have any Dwarapalakas on either side of this mantapa. That way it is an unfinished cave of Mamalla style. And secondly, this sculpture representation, what you call it as Sheshai, that means a reclining Vishnu. You could see the five kudus of this snake, and the snake bed, he was reclining on the snake bed, and over that you are having a Gandharvas, down also you are having a devotee. So these representations are all taking place at the end of Mahendra Varman. And this is another Devi killing Mahisha under Mahishasura Mardini cave. And you see that Durga is seated on a lion, and he was fighting with Mahishasura, that he is having a buffalo head. And other features, other sculptures are shown a little smaller in size, when the Mahishasura and the Mahishasura Mardini is shown in larger size. So that way, all the Ganas, what Shiva Ganas they call it in the Shiva panel. So these were the fighting scene or the battle scene between the Mahishasura and the Durga, that Mahishasura Mardini. So the next, so far we have seen that the introduction of rock cut cave with the Mahendra Varman first, and pillars are very short, and you don't have any kapota on the top, and the floor levels have shown with the difference with some little elevation, then Dwarapalakas on either side, and these are the pictures which we got from the Mahendra Varman style. But in the next one, we are moving from Mahendra style to Mamalla style. He also introduced several things in the rock cut case, but important one is the monolithic rathas. So introduction of vimanas and open air base relief. That open air base relief, the sculpture is engraved or sculpted on a open rocky surface. So the sculptural panels, that Arjuna pennants in Mahabalipuram is very famous one, that is belongs to the Mamalla or say Narasimha Varman first. So replacement of square pillars with decorated pillars or ornate pillars like lion bases. One of the important feature of this Mamalla style is at the base of the pillar you will be having a lion. So the Vyala, they call it, the Vyala base pillars are the time of Narasimha Varman first. So one can differentiate between the Mahendra Varman rocket cave and the Mamalla rocket cave. The base of the pillar will be having a lion. So the mandava has entablatures or prastara. We are having the prastara is finished with again kapota decorated with kudu motifs. The prastara had string of miniature shrines with salas and kutas above it. That means this one, the kutas and salas found on the as a string of shrines on the top or on the prastara, it is called hara. So this is an important feature of Mamalla, that it has been represented very well in all the temples, structural temples particularly. The pillars are taller and slender, or it is thinner, and the base of the often shaped with squatting lines. The maybe because of the experimentation which they had in Mahendravarman, they had a very massive pillars, and they would have believed that it can't withhold the weight of the upper rock mass. So by experience they would have learned that this much of massive rock is may not be required, pillar required, so that it can withhold all the weight. That way, Mamalla's time, the thickness of the pillar has been reduced. The pillars are taller, and as I told you, it is a thinner, and the base is having a squatting lines, what we popularly call vyalas. The top of the shaft of the pillar, the topmost part, and you are having the malasthana, that means loop of garlands will be there, and padmabandha, the lotus petals, also will be there. Then kalasa is on the top, vash and tadi, and it is shaped like a saucer, and kumbha, bulbous member will be there. Then pali, this is resembling a lotus but without any skull club petals. So then after that you are having a palaka. Palaka, above the palaka only you will be having that beam or cornice and beam. So the cave temples of Narasimhavarman, he has also excavated several cave temples around Mahabalipuram. Say Koneri Mandapam and Mahishasuramardhini Mandapam, Panchapandava Mandapam, Adivaraha Mandapam or Mahavaraha Vishnugraha, Ramanuja Mandapam, all are done during the time of Narasimhavarman first. See, this is one of the mantapa of Narasimhavarman first, the Mamalla style, what popularly called. You could see, based on the pillar alone, you can able to identify to which period it belongs. See, in earlier Mahendravarman pillar, you have seen that massive square pillar, and also sadram at the base, and sadram at the top, and octagonal at the center. But here, there is no square. Cubicle is removed. In the cubicle, sadram place, it is occupied by the lion. So at the base, he is having a lion. Lion also seated on small upapita, and your small base is given. So above this lion, that means that a pillar is emerging out of a lion. It is octagonal in shape. Again, you are having a batma and kumuda and kalasha, and also the top. You can see the top of the pillar, you are having a one palaka, the square plank will be there. Above this palaka, up to this palaka part is considered as a pillar, and above that you are having a cornice. And the cornice is, there is no much difference between the Mahendravarman cornice and also the carbal, and also the Narasimhavarman period carbal. And here again it is a kataranga is given, the wavy pattern is given in that carbal, and above that you are having a beam. And you could see that above the beam, the front facet, you are having a series of kud on the kapota. The one kapota means nothing but the water, the rainwater will not enter inside the cave. But in earlier stage, this type of provision is not given. So because of that, during the rainy season, the water may enter inside the cave. But when they have given this provision, what we call kapota, that means what they have experienced in the hut or in the houses, that also introduced in the cave. This cave where we having that kudu motif, that is what we have, the kapoda will be having kudu motif. Above that, you are having a series of shrines. That's what we call it, salas and kudus and panjaras, what they call it. This is the series of shrines on the top of the cave. Will be have called hara. So this hara is also found in other caves of Mamallas. So there are lot of difference. between or the evolutionary process is there between the Mahendravarman first and the Mamalla first. So because of that one, we are calling it as a Mahendravarman style and Mamalla style. So that way, this rock cut cave temple that has been introduced in India by the Ajvigis and Buddhists, and later on it has been followed by the Buddhist in Western Deccan and the area, and further it has been penetrated into the south. When it has been penetrated, still we don't know, but it has been believed that in Goa, the Aravallam cave is considered the earliest rock cut cave of South India, but belongs to, either it is belongs to Kadambas or it belongs to the Mauryas, still we don't know. But in the Chalukyas time, this temple has been introduced by this Mangalesha and Chalukya king, and after that it has been followed by the Pallavas. So that way, the Pallavas' contribution to the development of temple architecture is unmeasurable and immense. And his period is considered, or the Pallavas period is considered as a big change in the Tamil society. The Bhakti literature first time has been introduced, and monolithic Rathas has been introduced. The structural temples have been introduced, and the rock cut cave temples have been introduced. So several, and the kingship, the state formation, Chakravartin type of things has been introduced, and the early Pallavas copper plates or inscriptions are in Prakrit language, and only later on it has been, the Tamil language has been introduced into the Pallavas. So that way, there are several things have happened in the Pallava times. The introduction of cut-in rock-cut cave temples and cut-out monolithic or structural temples, execution of open-air sculptural reliefs, the introduction of Somaskanda panel and linga in the shrine, the sculptural panels on the rear walls, open-air sculptural relief like Arjuna penance paved a way for the acceleration of temple construction activities in Tamil Nadu, and the tradition started with the Pallavas continued with the same vigor till Vijayanagar and Nayak times in Tamil Nadu, and the tradition is still being continued even today. Thank you.